our sister, one with our brother, one family by the blood. Make us one. Bind us together, now and forever, Jesus be glorified.
Praise the Lord. How's everybody doing? Amen. You glad to be in the house of the Lord today? Amen. Let's give the Lord a praise. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord, for all that you're doing in our life. We're just so thankful for who you are, that you're our Father, that you're our God. We just thank you that you see ahead and provide, and you're working out all the details of our life. Lord, we thank you that you go before us and you make all the crooked places straight. Oh, we're just so thankful for your presence in this place. Holy Ghost, come do the things you want to do. Come say the things you want to say and have your way. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Yes. Go ahead and stand up with us.
Greatest day in history. Death is beaten, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. The empty cross. God like Jehovah. There's no 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 God like Jehovah. Behold, He comes. He's riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet. Declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trial, a famine and darkness in store, still we are the voice the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, He comes. He's riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes.
These are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest, the fields are as white as you are. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, He comes. He's riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes.
There's no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold, He comes. He's riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet's call, lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes.
Hallelujah, Lord, we praise You this morning.
No God like You. And Father, we're so thankful for what You're doing, Lord, in our country, in this world, that You're pouring out Your Spirit, Father, right down here to Texarkana in Free Life Church. Father, we're asking for the move of Your Spirit, Father. We're praying that each one of our leaders, Lord, our government leaders, our president, Father, all the leaders across this nation, speak to their hearts, think through their minds, surround them with godly people so that Your will divine will be revealed to them and they can walk in it. We're so thankful for the peace of God ruling in this country, because Your word says that if we lift up prayers for our leaders, that you would make sure that we would have peace. And Father, we thank you for your promises, which are yes and amen. Thank you for all that you're doing in our lives. We give you glory, honor, and praise in Jesus' mighty name. Amen, amen. Praise the Lord. Go ahead and be seated.
Praise the Lord. We're glad to see everyone here this morning. For those who made it out to a night or two or three of the revival, I know you guys experienced the Lord, and I believe that whatever he planted in your heart is going to grow and bring a harvest for his kingdom. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, I want to remind everyone, we have service tonight at 6 p.m., so be sure to come out for that. And also make plans, be making plans. We have the tickets on sale. Cheyenne, she has tickets for the crawfish boil and the catfish and all the food that we're going to have when Shane Warren is here. So be sure to see Cheyenne and get your ticket for your plate. And do we have anything else, Solly, that you need to announce? Youth rally coming up. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Well, turn to your neighbor and say, you are a blessing.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Well, God is good, isn't it? Isn't he? Everything he's doing in our life is good, and we're glad to see the moving of the Spirit and just glad to see people here after these meetings, because some of you might have wore you out. I don't know, but... Hopefully there was a great deposit in your spirit by it, and we had a great time just being a part of this this revival that they did. And if you came out some of the nights, hopefully you were blessed as well. Y'all ready to take up our tithes and offerings this morning?
Yeah.
How many of you know that you can't outgive God? Amen. Let me have some ushers come forward. Bible says, if you give, it's given unto you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. We enter into God's economy whenever we hook up with what he's doing and the way he does things. Amen. Hallelujah. Father, we just thank you for every person in this place. Lord, we just thank you that there's a spirit of liberality. We thank you, Lord, that we're working in this thing together. We're working in this field together and each doing our part as you speak to our hearts. We're just so thankful for it. In Jesus' name, amen, amen.
Hallelujah.
Stand up and worship with us. Hallelujah. Lord, we praise you this morning, Jesus. Hallelujah. You know, we might have had a long weekend and we might be tired this morning, but we're here to serve the King of Kings this morning, to lift up praise to Jesus, to worship his name, because he's worthy this morning, church. So I invite you, please enter in this morning and worship the Lord, because he's a good, good Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You are living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the
songs that we sing, But prayer and praise is literally praying to the Lord. When we're worshiping, we're praying to the Lord. These are prayers that we're praying. And you're telling the Lord, hey, you're welcome here. Come flood this place. Come fill the atmosphere. And your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. Isn't that right? To be overcome by His presence. You know, it's not so much about if you like the song or if you don't like the song. It's more about God. Amen. It's more about Him, because we're giving Him praise and Him glory. And so, and He likes a variety of different types of music, and He's a very, look at your neighbor. You can tell He's a God of variety just by looking around. God likes variety, amen. And it wasn't too long ago, some of these older songs that we like was actually newer songs to some other people that they didn't quite like. Amen. But what we want to do is we want a worshiping congregation here. Jesus walks in the midst of a worshiping congregation. Amen. We're not singing for us, we're singing for Him. Thank you, Lord. We're singing to you, Lord. This is all for you, Jesus. And we just thank you for what you're doing in this place. Out in our lives, Lord, help us to see greater and deeper than we ever have before. Lord, open up our hearts and open up our eyes that we may know you, that we may know the power of your resurrection and share in the fellowship of your sufferings, that we might be lifted up from among the dead even while in the body. Oh, we're just so thankful that we're pressing to see more. We're not satisfied with what we have and what we know, but we're pressing for the more. Somebody say, I want more. Someone say, I want more, Lord. More of you. That's what John said. John said, I must decrease, the Baptist. I must decrease and He must increase. See, the more of us we have in our life, the less of God we have in our life. Because there's only room for one on our hearts. And the more we have of ourself, and the more we have of I, the less we have of Him. And I don't know about you, but if I got a lot of me, I got a little bit of God. If I got a lot of God, I got a little bit of me. And it balances out that way. Amen? How about none of me and all of God? Amen. I just want the Lord to do what He wants to do. Hallelujah. We thank you, Father. Just give Him praise one more time. Father, we thank you. Thank you, Lord, for the faithful people. Lord, thank you for faithful people in this church. We're so thankful, God, for faithful people. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. You're faithful to us, and what can we do in return but be faithful to you? And be faithful to your house. And Lord, I ask you to bless. Lord, I ask for a special blessing for the faithful ones in this house, God. Lord, touch them. Oh, touch their household, Father. You said the blessing of the Lord makes one rich and adds no sorrow with it. Father, I pray that the blessing of God would add no sorrow in their life and would multiply in their life. Just for what they do for your name's sake. I just thank you, Father, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen, amen, hallelujah. Go ahead and be seated. Praise the Lord. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Well, we're glad you're here today. Amen? Because if you weren't, I'd just be preaching to the chairs. I have been known to do that before. I remember I was leading a Bible study. Probably around 2006 or 7. And, you know, we had a lot of different people that would come and go into Bible studies and stuff. And so, anyways, this one particular Bible study we was having, nobody showed up because I think the fair was in town. And everybody went to the fair. And so I said to the Lord, I said, well, it's my day to do the Bible study. So, you know, I'm going to go ahead and have Bible study. I don't know if anybody's going to show up or not. And so I did. I went in there and not a soul showed up but me. Christine wasn't even there. I don't know where she was. I think we were friends at the time. But she might have went to the fair. I don't know. But anyways, I showed up and all those white chairs were out there. And I started preaching on seed time and harvest. Because God's faithful. If you sow a seed, God is he's faithful to make that seed grow. So I preach all them chairs about seed time and harvest. That's what I was doing right there. I was sowing. I was sowing to the Spirit. Wasn't nobody else there, but God was there. I was there. And he saw my faithfulness, and he saw that I wasn't going to quit. I wasn't going to back down. I wasn't going to get discouraged, but I was just going to keep on going for him. Why is that? Because the Bible says we walk by faith and not by sight. I'm not moved by what I see. Because if you're moved by what you see, you'll be moved all the time by the winds and the waves in the world. You have to walk by faith. If it was there, faith wouldn't be necessary. Amen? Because if you see it, it's not faith. It's reality. But sometimes you have to faith it until you make it. You got to put your faith out there and believe God. Amen. For this church, you need to be pointing to some chairs and say, that chair's full right there. Amen. We got so many people coming in here, hungry for the true word of the Lord, not for religion, hungry for the word of God, hungry for the Spirit of God. They want a good balance of both in their life so they can make it to when Jesus comes back. Amen. And start pointing to the balcony, saying, that balcony's full. The word's getting out about what God's doing at Free Life Church. Amen. Amen. In your own life, you got some things going on. You need to apply your faith to it. Because they may not change. Because I hate to tell you this, besides me, there's probably nobody else around that likes you more than you. Nobody has your intentions any more than you have them. Besides me, I'm praying. I love each and every one of you. Just know that. I got you on my mind all the time. I'm praying for you and praying for your family. So besides me, there's nobody else that's praying for you like you're praying for you. So you got to have your faith on the line about stuff and not try to put it in someone else's pocket. Well, I just hope it all works out. It may not work out if you don't extend some faith out there. If you don't start believing, we walk by faith and not by sight. We can have some good Holy Ghost services, let the Lord move mightily, but when you leave here, the rubber is going to meet the road. And that preacher ain't going to be here to excite you and preach you through it. You're going to have something carry you when that person's getting upset with you. When you run into old crazy. When your mind starts going tilt. When you wake up and your body's aching. When something's going on in your life where you need something to happen, amen, we're believing God for things, but that preacher ain't going to be there all the time trying to lift you up. You got to have some word that's going to sustain you. That's what we do here. We're going to give you the word, and then you take the word of God, and you take what you receive by the Spirit of God, and you go out, and you're an overcomer. And you say, like Caleb said, we're well able to overtake the land. Amen. There was only two spies that came back, and they came back with a good report. Remember Numbers chapter 13? They came back with a good report. What happened to the other 10? Oh, they came back with an evil report. They said, you know, there was some big fruit, just like you said, and the land flowing with milk and honey. It was just like you said, but I didn't even got to my message yet. I don't know if we'll get there or not. We'll see. But they said, but the giants in the land are huge. They begin to take their eyes off the promise of God, and they put their eyes on the process that God was getting ready to take them through. And rather than the promise, they had their eyes on the process, and even though they had to go through the process, they had to have a spirit of faith to get through that thing, and they didn't have it. Joshua and Caleb did. They said, listen, it's just like that. Look, here's the grapes right here. But we're well able to overtake the land. We can do it. Come on, shout out loud. We can do it. We're well, that's a spirit of faith. But the 10, here's what they said. This is interesting here. They said, you know, it was just like what you said, and we look small in our own eyes, like grasshoppers. So they acknowledged the problem, but then they had a mentality about themselves that was small. And they said, in our own eyes, we're like grasshoppers. Well, see, Joshua and Caleb, they're the only ones out of that bunch, amen, that entered into the promised land. None of them other grumbling and complaining people did. So listen, we're going to enter into the promised land. We're going to believe God. We're going to move forward into what God's called us to do, which is great things for Him, amen? Jesus turned the known world upside down with 12 people. The book of Acts tells us. Wow. 12 souls. And they weren't some big religious. They were some cussing, drinking fools. They'll sit on there and fish and get drunk. Tax collectors, you know how crooked they are. My Lord. Look at the IRS, you know. And Jesus decided, you know what? These people, these pompous people over here, beating their chest on the corner, talking about how big they tithe, how great they pray, how great. I'm going to bypass them, and I'm going to find some people that nobody else believes in. I'm going to find some people that are rough. I'm going to find some people who know how to not give up, who know how to press through some hard times. And he did. He found them 12 disciples and began to disciple them. And one was even a devil, and he still discipled him. He said, I'm going to pick out 11 good ones and one bad one just to test my faith walk, my love walk. Sometimes you got to have a devil around you just to test your love walk, make sure you're doing things right. And not only that, but Jesus sat across the table from that man and gave him the treasury. He knew about him, and he still gave him the treasury. Now, we hadn't done that here at this church, and we ain't going to do it. We ain't got that much faith. We ain't going to put no crooked people out there. Except for Brother Archie. I'm not quite sure about him yet. No, I'm just kidding. Man, you're talking about faithfulness. Hallelujah. But, you know, Judas came about, and he knew about him, and he still allowed him to do that. And that's the thing. And he loved him in spite of him, and still gave him an opportunity to repent at the end, and he didn't do it. He went and hung himself. See, he could have repented just like Judas did. Just like Peter did. Because Peter did the same thing that Judas did, but they dealt with it differently at the end. Peter went fishing and Judas went to hang himself. Judas, he ended it before it could have got better. And that's what we do a lot in our lives. We end things before they get better because we get our eyes off what the promise is and we start putting it on the process, you know, and we start questioning. Amen? This is true, isn't it? So let's go ahead and let's get started on this then. That was a good introduction, wasn't it? Don't take it off my time. Go with me to 1 Samuel chapter 16. We're beginning a new series led by the Holy Spirit called The Process, God's Process. Someone say God's Process. Do you know God has a process for each of us? 1 Samuel chapter 16 and verse 1. It says, Now the Lord said to Samuel, How long will you mourn for Saul, seeing I have rejected him from reigning over Israel? Fill your horn with oil and go. I am sending you to Jesse, the Bethlehemite, for I have provided myself a king among his sons. And Samuel said, How can I go? If Saul hears it, he will kill me. But the Lord said, Take a heifer with you and say, I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Then invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do. You shall anoint for me the one I name to you. So Samuel did what the Lord said, amen, and he went to Bethlehem. And the elders of the town trembled at his coming, and said, "Do you come peaceably?" And he said, "Peaceably I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Sanctify yourself and come with me to the sacrifice." Then he consecrated Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. So it was when they came that he looked at Eliab and said, "Surely the Lord's anointed is before him." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look at his appearance," right? "Or at his physical stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord does not see," watch this, "as man sees. For man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." Skip on down to verse 11. And it says, "And Samuel said to Jesse," he done went through all his sons. You ever felt like you've went through all the answers and you couldn't find it? You're like, "We done went through all of these." Well, there's a ram in the thicket. God still has something out there. Look at this. "Samuel said to Jesse, are all the young men here?" Then he said, "There remains yet the youngest. And there he is keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and bring him, for we will not sit down till he comes here." And he sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy with bright eyes and good looking. And the Lord said, "Arise." In other words, he was a knucklehead. The Lord said, "Arise, anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel took the horn of his oil and anointed him in the midst of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. So Samuel arose and went to Ramah. Go ahead and sit on down. Praise the Lord. Amen. Someone say, David was anointed to be king. So God had a promise. He had a place for David to be at, to take Saul's place. And so Samuel came in and he got anointed, and he was anointed in front of everybody. The anointing flowed on him, all of his family and everyone that was there saw exactly that David was anointed to be king. Guess where David went next? Well, he went and took his throne. No, that ain't what happened. What happened? He went back to tend the sheep. David wasn't made king right then. Why was he anointed? Anybody know? The anointing was a reminder of the promise that the process would bring. Go ahead and write that down. The anointing was a reminder to David of the promise that the process would bring. God has a process in each one of our lives, and God has spoken a word to us, and he has given us a dream, he has given us a vision, he has told us some things, and given us an anointing as a reminder that, hey, there's no expiration date on this thing. What I said to you, you can take it to the bank. It's just as true as I'm true, and I'm not giving up on you. God's not giving up on us. We give up on ourselves. We divert from God's process sometimes because of the pain we experience in the process. So what is a process? A process is a series of actions or steps taken in order to achieve a particular end. God knew that some things needed to happen in David's life, watch this, before he could be king. In the same way, there are some things that need to happen to us in our lives before we can step into what God has for us to step into. Hallelujah. Some of you, you know, you've gone through life and you've experienced some things, and you're getting on up in age, but there is no expiration date on what God says. Amen. He still do it. He's still God on the throne. He's still working. He's still moving. He's still planning. And he's got a process that he's brought us through. Y'all, I'm reminded of this Chinese bamboo tree. Y'all ever heard about that thing? So the Chinese bamboo tree, this tree begins as a nut planted in the soil and must be watered and fertilized every single day. Someone say every day. For 5 years. You can't miss a day. For 5 years before it finally breaks through the ground. So you have to sit over this Chinese bamboo tree, water it, don't you miss a day, for 5 years. And all that time, it spreads out its roots underneath the soil. And if at any time the watering or fertilizing process stops, the Chinese bamboo tree dies in the ground. But in that fifth year, the Chinese bamboo tree finally breaks through the ground and grows to nearly 90 feet tall. 90 feet. Isn't that amazing? In just 6 weeks. So for 5 years you're watering this thing, you don't even see nothing breaking through the ground. You haven't missed a day. Some of us would get discouraged after the first week. But in that fifth year, it rises up and it grows 90 feet tall. Is that what I said? 90 feet tall. Let me find my place here. Yeah, in just 6 weeks. The tree must take 5 long years of developing a strong, deep, wide root system so it doesn't topple over when it is grown. And we tend to get frustrated, amen, when we don't get 5-year results immediately. The truth is, the process is essential, and everyone must go through the process to get the results. The question is, will you allow the waiting to develop you or to embitter you? Don't shout me down now just because I'm preaching real good. So will we allow the process of God in our life to develop us to where we take things and we're growing with them, and we're taking even negative things and growing from those negative things? Because you can grow from any situation. And you take that and you say, you know what, I'm going to use it and I'm going to grow and let it develop me, or will you let it get you bitter? Hallelujah. Boy, I knew this would be a good message here. You know, the word bitter, if you take the word bitter, B-I-T-T-E-R, and you remove one letter, instead of bitter, it reads better. You just exchange the E for an I and the I for an E. And what was supposed to be a bitter thing will now make you better because of your perspective, because you understand that God is bringing you through His process. Amen. It's not the process of man. It's not his process, her process. But I trust in the Lord. Amen. Some trust in chariots and some trust in horses. But I trust in the name of the Lord. Amen. Let's give the Lord praise. Go ahead. We're going to trust in the Lord, you know, in this process. That's why I'm so strong and such an advocate on what you see. Because what you see will fool you. That bamboo tree, you just look at it from the outward perspective and you're not seeing what's going on underneath the soil. You're not seeing that big root system that's going to uphold the 90-foot tall bamboo tree in 6 weeks. You're not seeing that, so you can get easily discouraged. You can't walk by what you see. Amen? Praise the Lord. We have to trust in God's process. Well, you know, I've just been praying for a spouse and God hadn't brought nobody yet for me. God will bring the right person at the right time. You just got to worry about continuing to water and fertilize what God's told you, not getting discouraged. Amen? Well, I've been praying about this ailment for a long time. I've been suffering with it. Well, there's a process sometimes. You know, sometimes God will bring your healing right then. But if He doesn't bring it right then, I'm trusting God that I'm already healed right now. I'm just waiting on what God said to catch up with what I believe. I'm just waiting on the manifestation of it. It's already mine. Brother Pilgrim here. Oh, man, 6 years. Wasn't it 6 years? Went through the all of that stuff with rheumatoid arthritis and all that kind of stuff. He was in a wheelchair, confined to a wheelchair, and the Lord led him to get some surgery on it. The Lord might lead you to get some surgery. Amen. We got to use wisdom. I mean, we can believe God, but he knows if your faith is it can be there or if it can't. So he might bring you through that process of going to that doctor. But don't you go just trusting in that doctor. You better go trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ as being your healer. And what happened? Now he's walking. His next is his hands. He's going to work on his hands next. But, you know, God's still using them. And you can't get discouraged and get locked up in what's going on right now. It might still be underground. But in that fifth year, it's going to come up so big and so mighty and so great because that's who God is. Amen. God is not a God of, he's a God of overflow. He's not a God of a little bit. He's a God of overflow. It says in John 10:10 that the thief comes but to steal, kill, and destroy. He said, but I have come that you may have life and that you may have it more abundantly. You know, the Amplified Bible says that you may have life in abundance to the full till it overflows. You know, God wants the overflow in your life. He wants it to flow over. He wants it to grow 90 feet tall in 6 weeks. But we just can't give up in the process, and we're waiting on things to happen. And God says, hey, listen, I'm working. Don't you give up. Don't you get tired. Don't you get weary, because I am the I am. I am the great I am. And we can trust in him. Hallelujah. David, you know, David didn't allow himself to get bitter in the process, but he got better instead. He went in that cave, and he could have killed Saul right there. He had that knife in his hand. What'd he do? Just cut a little bit of that scarf, a little bit of that robe off. That's all he did. Why? He kept his integrity even when he didn't see the promise manifesting. He said, you know what, Lord, you anointed me. I'm anointed by you, not by man. You sent Samuel to me to anoint me. So he continued. You know, the first time he saw Saul, that doesn't sound right, does it? First time he saw King Saul, we'll put a word in between those so it don't sound strange. What did he do? He played the harp and he got the evil spirits. He could have let them evil spirits kill him. Drive him crazy like Nebuchadnezzar eating grass outside. But he didn't. He went in there and he said, you know what? I'm just going to serve and I'm just going to love the Lord and I'm going to use my gift to serve the kingdom. I'm going to use my gift to serve the Lord because I'm not trusting in man. I'm not working for man. God sees me everywhere I go, everything I do, every thought and intent of my heart. So I'm going to serve him. Even if this person's not right or I'm not sure about this, I'm going to serve the Lord. And he did. And those evil spirits left because of the anointing on his life. You never know because of the anointing God put on your life what he's doing through you to touch others. Amen? Hallelujah. So he got better instead. He said, I'm just going to keep my integrity. Then came the day when Goliath showed up. That big Goliath, 9 feet tall. You know, Clarence was 16 feet tall. Some of y'all will get that later. I'll tell you the joke later, but I'm not going to go into it right now, but it is funny. Chris is back there laughing. He's heard it. But he was 9 feet tall, 9 inches. So he stands there, and what happens? David shows up to where he is, and he's already defeated the lion. He's already defeated the bear. He's protected the sheep, and God was training him in the process. But see, If he would have went back there to the field and say, I'm anointed as king. God's called me to do this. And stuck his nose up in the air and he didn't watch those sheep, he might have never ran into that lion and that bear. And he may have never been prepared for Goliath because he didn't stick out the process. Amen. We abort the process in our life. We say, you know what, God, I want the promise, but I'm just going to abort this pain. I'm going to abort this process that's going on in my life. I'm going to go do something easier. It's human nature to want to do things that's easier. But God nature is to stick it through. God nature is to get in there and grab the horns of the altar and believe God and say, you know what, I'm not going to give up. I know what you call me to do. I know the word that you place on the inside of me. Hallelujah. I know what your word says. Your word is life to those who find it, healing to all of their flesh. Oh, your word is true. It doesn't return void, but it accomplishes that which you send it to do. But David said, you know what? I'm not going to get bitter in this process. I'm going to get better. You know what bitterness is? Write this down. Bitterness is unbelief in the promise of God. Bitterness is unbelief in the promise of God. In other words, I'm getting bitter because, God, I don't believe that you're really going to do what you said you're going to do. And it's unbelief in God's promise. I knew you guys would just be excited about this. I know you're listening. You're soaking it in. I see that sponge out there. You're soaking it in. The Lord told me that. Bitterness is unbelief in the promise of God. Is he going to come through? He always does. And thank God he comes through even when we give up. Even when we're sitting under that tree. He might come curse that tree and let it dry up, but he's going to come through. God's going to come through for you. We just got to trust in him. Hallelujah. And protect our heart. We talked about that Wednesday. Got to protect our heart. Hebrews chapter 6. Let's go to a scripture here. Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 12. It says that you, Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 12, that you do not become sluggish. Someone say sluggish. Uh-oh. But imitate those who through faith and what? And patience. Shout it out loud. And patience inherit the promises. So how do we inherit the promises of God? Through faith and patience. These are the wonder twins of receiving from the Lord. You got to have faith, but you also have to have patience. Do you know what patience is? Patience in the Hebrew, if you go look it up, it means to abide under something. You're not aborting the process, but you're abiding under something and believing God. You can't just be patient. Because then there's no faith attached to the patience. And you can't just have faith because then you just give up when it doesn't look like it's going to come through. It doesn't look true. But you got to have both. You know, I'm going to believe God. What else am I going to do? I'm going to abide under until the Lord comes in and makes the change. Until my reality lines up with what the Word says. Hallelujah. Amen. I got to get my reality. I got to get what I see lining up with what God said and what's in my spirit and what he's placed in me. We got a process we're going through. We got a process. And we got to have both things working in order to see God's promise fulfilled. Someone say trust. Shout out loud, trust. Lord, we trust in you. We trust in you, Lord. You have to have trust in God in the process. And we don't like that because we're a microwave generation. Some of you, listen, some of you older folks are like that too. You want it now. You better get it now, boy. Get after it. And we get caught up in that of wanting it now. And what we got to do is we have to have trust. Trust right in the middle of where we're at. Proverbs chapter 3 and verse 5 and 6. It says, trust in the Lord with all of your heart, not part of your heart, all of your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. But man, we are so good at leaning on our own understanding. Well, I know this. Well, I've seen this. You know, this is my experiences right here, Lord. Listen, that ain't in my vocabulary what you're telling me. I'm going to be a father of many nations, and I don't even have a kid, and I'm almost 100 years old. Leaning on my understanding. I'm leaning on my experiences more than I'm trusting in the Lord. See, trust involves you taking your eyes off what you know and placing them on the stars in the sky and the sand of the sea and say, God, I'm going to trust you for what you said to me. Hallelujah. This is a bad situation, Lord, but I know that your word declares that you are a restorer of paths to dwell in. Lord, that you can go and you can restore the years that the cankerworm and the caterpillar and the palmerworm has eaten. You can restore years in my life. You can bring about 5 years of waiting and not seeing anything happening. And then all of a sudden, that bamboo tree goes shooting up. And now you got 90 feet tall fruit happening because you didn't abandon God. You didn't abandon what he said. You didn't abandon what his word said to you, but you held out to the end. You stuck in the process. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Look at the next one. In all of your ways, acknowledge him, worship him, have intimate fellowship with him. That's what that means. And he shall direct your paths. Wait upon the Lord, and he will renew your strength. You'll mount up with wings like eagles. The reason a lot of people don't mount up with wings like eagles because they let the devil come and clip their wings. But God's a restorer. God's faithful. God's true. He's alive and he's living. And he deposited his spirit on the inside of us. Thanks be to God who always leads us in triumph. But just because you're anointed doesn't mean you're appointed yet. See, David was anointed, but it wasn't his appointed time. His appointment was in the field. And his appointment was going to see Goliath. His appointment was that process God was taking him through. And each season changed differently. But he was anointed to be king, but he wasn't appointed yet. Someone say process. Shout out loud, say process. David was anointed and then went back to tending sheep. He was anointed to be king, but God called him to stay in the process that would actually be the preparation that he needed. Maybe I'm just preaching myself happy. I don't know here. Maybe I'm the only one got a process going on. Hallelujah. We all got a process going on, and that process may be the preparation that we need that's going to sustain us and be our root structure in the ground that's going to hold up that big tower that the Lord brings. Hallelujah. Woo, thank you, Jesus. Preparation time is never wasted time. I'm finishing right here. Man, y'all are getting out of here early tonight or this morning. Praise God. You can come back tonight. Preparation time is never wasted time. Say, preparation time is never wasted time. Don't get off the potter's wheel while he is working. Don't abort the process. Don't be like these thousands of women who go and abort. We don't believe in abortion. Amen. They go and abort that baby when they could have had that baby and someone, another family that couldn't have babies could adopt that baby and raise that baby. There's always an answer for it, but we can't, just like that's naturally, spiritually, we can't abort the process of God. So you know what? I've got this going on in my life. This is true. I'm not sticking my head in the sand and denying it, but it's true. But I'm trusting in what God says above what I see. Amen? Prepare, because preparation time is never wasted time in your life. Prepare for what God has for you. Amen? Did you get something out of that today? Praise the Lord. Go ahead and stand up with me. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Well, I want to pray for you right now. You may be watching online, maybe in here, and maybe you've never met Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. This is so important here because he is the gateway. He is the doorway. He is the way in, the way, the truth, and the life. And we can't get to God except through Jesus Christ. So if you've never met him as your Lord and Savior, I want to pray for you right now and let you meet him. Or maybe you have, but you've gone away. If that's you, I just want you to pray this prayer. And everyone in here, pray this prayer with me. Say, Lord, thank you for dying on the cross. Thank you for going through the process of the death, burial, and resurrection that you experienced so that I might have life. Thank you for not aborting the process you went through so that I can have true life. Come live in my heart. I repent of my sins. Wash me clean, Jesus. In Jesus' name. I can't do it by myself. Fill me with your Spirit so I can have strength to live this life. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the Lord. Glory be to God. Father, we worship you. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. We're going to end our live stream here. And I want to pray for you. If you have something going on that is...